Welcome again, friends, to another short yet biblical lesson in the ongoing series, Hey Doc, Stop Lying on Jesus. And we want to get straight to it today with you. We got something that you really, really need to hear, and just sit back and take a few minutes out of your week, out of your day, out of your month, whatever that is, and hear this, because this is really, I believe, going to bless your soul. I'm going to read 2 Samuel, the 6th chapter, and I'm going to start reading at the 15th verse. And once I start reading, you'll know what this scripture is all about. 2 Samuel, 6th chapter, starting at the 15th verse. So it says, "So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought the ark of the Lord in about six, and set it in its place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And as soon as David had made an end of offering burnt offerings and peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. And he dealt among all the people, even among the whole multitude of Israel, as well as to the women, as to the men, to everyone he gave a piece of flesh and a flag of wine. So all the people departed, everyone unto his house. And then David returned and blessed his household. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, 'How glorious was the king of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of his handmaids and of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovereth himself.' And David said unto Michal, 'It was before the Lord, which chose me before your father and before all his house to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord, over Israel. Therefore I play before the Lord,'" listen to this, "'and I will yet be more vile than that, and will be abased in mine own sight. And of the maidservants which you talking about, of them shall I be had honor with.'" And this is, we've heard that song that said, dancing like David danced before the Lord. And when the spirit of the Lord moves upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I want to tell you all this, is that although that song is very well meaning, and although it is for praise and worship, I want to encourage you today from this thought: dance your own dance. Again, dance your own dance. This is a very known, very well known passage in the Bible. Again, as we said, it was something that many songs have been made about, dancing like David danced. And David, after years, let me give you a little backdrop to this. After years of being on the run from Saul, David finally was moved out of the way by his own sword. He ran himself through with the sword because years before, the Lord had removed favor from Saul, because Saul had disobeyed the Lord. And we know that Samuel the prophet went out to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, and looked over his sons as a replacement for Saul. And the interesting thing was, is that the first or the second, can't remember right now, of Jesse's sons that Saul looked over reminded him of Saul. He was a big old strapping kid and all these other things. But the Bible says that the Lord doesn't, in those passages, the Lord doesn't look on the heart, doesn't look on men as others might look on it. So David was anointed king years before that. So when we fast forward, and that was, favor was withdrawn from Saul in 1 Samuel in the 15th chapter. So David was brought before Saul in 1 Samuel the 16th chapter to play a harp to ease Saul's soul, because Saul was sore vexed and he became Saul's armor bearer. Now, we also know that the beginning of Saul's problem with David was that David came and he slayed Goliath, and there was a song that people were singing, and that song was, David, Saul slayed his thousands, but David his 10,000s. And this was a song that was said, and even today in modern times, especially in the fellowships, Many pastors are guilty of the sin of Saul, because they'll see some associate minister that is serving with them, trying to be obedient to the Lord, and people will, they in their eyes, they will see people talking about this associate ministers, and if you didn't know, pastors are pretty much some of the most insecure people you'll ever meet. Yet they say they move by faith and they do this thing, but their biggest fear is that the people will choose somebody else to run the church and not them. They're not walking with the Lord like they say they are. And instead of nurturing those gifts in those ministers that serve with them, because of their fear, they don't nurture those gifts. Some jealousy enters in, because again, they see the people. I want to tell you pastors that serve by yourself, because I don't want no mess from no associate ministers. No, you don't want people looking anywhere else except you, not understanding that there are associate ministers who want to be obedient to your leadership. But because of your fear, because people may say what the people in David's time said, is that brother pastor Slay preaches to his thousands, but this associate minister to his 10,000s. Y'all need to repent of that. That's a bunch of sin and it's a bunch of foolishness. So again, this is the beginning of the issue with Saul and David. And when David brought the ark into the city, singing and shouting before the Lord, he pretty much stripped down to his boxers and was singing. And the Bible says he had a little ephod on. And this is why Michael, Saul's daughter, said he shamelessly uncovered himself in front of his handmaidens. To what David responded is, I'm going to do something more vile than this, you see. And he then said, those same maids that you're talking about, I'm going to have honor in their sight. So it would be like that encounter would be sort of like, anyway, the president of the United States coming in, and he's walking before the limo, the presidential limo. He strips down to his boxers and he's just praising the Lord, singing and shouting before the Lord. Certainly the news would say the president had a psychotic break, and they'd have these experts on to analyze his psychology and all these things. And not comparing a presidential limo to the Ark of God, but the comparison is relative a little bit, I think. And the president singing and shouting the Lord, saving the Lord, brought him out after many years of suffering. And this is what happens. And then Michelle Obama looks out on Pennsylvania Avenue on the White House and say, man, why Barack in his drawers out there embarrassing me like that? And then the president comes in and she said, man, you all be ashamed of yourself doing that. But again, this is kind of the scene that was set. So the question I want to ask all of you today briefly is this, is, and you need to answer this, and is, how do you dance your own dance in front of the Lord? The first thing that anybody that says they're a believer in Yeshua HaMashiach or Jesus the Christ, whom the Western world knows as Jesus the Christ, has to do is repent of their sins. Listen, many of y'all are held back right now because you're at a place that the Lord doesn't want you at, doing some things that the Lord doesn't have you doing. Now, you would swear up and down that it is the Lord having you do it. But at the same time, you have to understand that anything the Lord does through you is going to be through the gifting that he has given you. This is it. You know, we have people that are in teachers or that are in pulpits that the Lord will show them a word or reveal some words to their mind. And all of a sudden, they think that they're a preacher, when all the Lord is trying to do is show them maybe how to manage their own house better, how to be a better servant in the fellowship, or how to bless the kingdom more. But the Lord reveals a little bit of his word, and all of a sudden, oh, I'm a preacher because I can memorize some scripture. They're dancing somebody else's dance. And one thing that I want to encourage also all of you to understand is this, is that many times, and especially speaking to associate ministers, you commit the sin of Absalom. And Absalom, we know, was David's son many years after the scriptures that we're talking to you about right now. And Absalom stood by the gate and he saw what the king had, and he wanted in his heart to be the judge of the people. So some decades passed, and slowly he was picking away at what the Lord was doing for David. And he hijacked the throne. Today it would be called a coup d'etat. And because he wanted what God had blessed David with. And you got your eye on the pastor, if it's a real pastor and not some Negro preacher clown that's up there Lord, and doing all this other stuff. Black pastors are woefully inadequate at giving people information. They'll entertain you, but they don't give you the information. So I digress. So what I am saying here today is this, is that you have to, in order to dance your own dance, you've got to repent of your sins. Associate ministers, what the Lord has for the man of God is what he has for the man of God. And what he's going to do for you, he's going to do for you. This the church is not corporate America. And I know you see people like T.D. Jakes and these other clowns calling themselves CEOs and motivational speakers and all this other stuff. The church is not corporate America where I'm going to put my time in. I'm going to sit up under the man of God and put my time and gain experience, and then I'll be a pastor. It doesn't work like that. Remember, you quote the scripture that says God's thoughts are not your thoughts, neither his ways your ways. Everything you know about the world is exactly opposite in the kingdom of God. And many people live their lives bitter because they're not dancing their own dance. They become jealous and envious and covetous because they're not dancing their own dance. They're not focusing on those things that the Lord God of hosts has for them and the thing that the Lord God of hosts wants to do through them. So, and again, I'll give you a couple examples. I think a great example in the world is, and most especially in the black community, if somebody has a heart of giving, and let's just say there's a single mother who needs help with her children or her kid. If that man who's not dating that woman or he's not the kid's father tries to help this woman out, he is subject to be called a trick. You see, and this is by believers, and they forget the scripture that says if you see someone that has need and you have this world's goods and you don't give it to them, how dwelleth the love of God in you? So the Lord has made me to dance a dance of giving. Yet if I give, I'm called a trick. If I'm giving to a woman that's struggling with her kids and I don't have anything to gain, I'm called Captain Save-A-Ho and all of these other things. This is just where people are. So and religious traditions has got you dancing somebody else's dance, people. You have to understand that I am not one. Very many younger pastors and preachers will try to snub their nose at the former generations who we call the Negro preacher, the old church, the old Negro preacher. And you can see billboards that'll say this is not your grandmother's church and all this stuff. You pastors that do that, you're in sin, because this is the thing. The Bible says, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. The word of God says, although heaven and earth may pass away, my word will not pass away. So you burning bridges that allowed you to cross over to where you are, for you to even stand up and make that statement makes you a religious hypocrite. There is no wisdom in burning a bridge that has allowed you to spiritually cross over. So y'all need to quit talking about them folk like that, because your stank butt wouldn't even be able to stand up and say that if it wasn't for those people that marched. So I'll leave that alone right now. But many of you are dancing the dance of your religious traditions. Black folk know how to be spiritual, but we lack information. And I will say this, is that if you ever want to see an unprepared preacher or a professing preacher, if I call somebody a preacher or a pastor, please understand this is not me validating what they say they are, bishop, apostle, whatever they are. This is just what they call themselves. So when you see these people, they will go around and they'll get up and they'll say absolutely nothing, or they'll start hooping, which means they're unprepared. Now, 90% of the time that's true. Now, I've only met one preacher that actually hoops with substance, one. And this is because generation after generation after generation are dancing the religious tradition dance of their fathers, and the church is just dying. We are in an age, where the Bible says the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, and after them, their own selves, teachers having itching ears. We see these mega churches dancing the dance of the devil, and they are great at giving information, but they're giving bad information. And And another example of what I was talking about with the woeful inadequacy of professing pastors and preachers giving information is a scandal-ridden Eddie Long. Listen to Eddie Long. Listen to Eddie Long. Now, I ain't saying swallow what he tells you, but this is a great example. Eddie Long never says anything. He just doesn't. Brian Carnes, the so-called prophet Brian Carnes, never says anything. Juanita Bynum never says anything. They never say anything. Leroy Thompson, Pip Extraordinaire, never says anything. So again, they give information, but the information they give is bad. And the Bible says of these sorts are ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth, people. So I want to get to my first point, and my first point is this. The way you exercise your gift or your calling should always be because of development of the Holy Ghost, and never because of your admiration for others. Again, the way you exercise your gift or your talent should always be a result of Holy Ghost development and never as a result of your admirations for others. The short story, even shorter, is you don't need no Christian role model. Now, if they're walking in holiness and doing those things, they must be living according to the word. The only wannabe you should be is a wannabe disciple of Jesus. This is it. The world will say, well, you need positive role models. There are positive people that were positive in this life in hell right now. Good people don't go to heaven, and bad people don't go to hell. Saved people that believe on the blood of Jesus go to heaven, and people that don't believe on the blood of Jesus and his sacrifice and resurrection on the cross, those people go to hell. So again, it has to be Holy Ghost development and not as a result of your admiration for others. It breaks my heart. There's this baby they call Baby T.D. Jakes. Boy, y'all, you listen, if you the mama, you know that them people, you need to say something to them, because T.D. Jakes is a reprobate. He's a false prophet. Don't speak that curse on your children. You know, I saw a young preacher, man. It used to be just a fine and great young preacher. And he started off, man, and his word was powerful. They had 3 years later, you know, this back padding that Negro pastors do. This back padding session that these people do happens because Negro pastors, when they get in their little haydock circles, they'll pat a preacher on the back and say, boy, you going pastor, and all this other stuff like this. So fast forward, he started a church, and the next thing, 3 years later, I see this clown, and he's like, just being a total jerk and backslidden and acting as a Negro pastor, dancing somebody else's dance. This is how it is. And I want to just encourage again young ministers to understand the Lord may not have raised most of y'all up to do what them Negro preachers do, and some of them still do as hoop. He raised you up to give information. He raised you up to bless the people with his word. And that requires you understanding whether he made you to be a prophet, an apostle, an evangelist, a pastor, a teacher. This is what the Bible says he made some to be, on and on and on and on. So forget the role model thing. Walk in the Holy Ghost and let him develop you. My second point, the real shame is never who God made you to be. It's refusing to walk in it. Again, my second point is the real shame is never who God made you to be, but refusing to walk in it. I knew a church lady that, again, once said, this young preacher was up there and he was giving information. He wasn't being a clown Negro preacher. This one was in her 70s, black, church had all that other stupidity and all that stuff they used to do, covering the outside, but on the inside they were a mess. And she said, oh, he ain't no preacher. Again, trying to shame this man, like Michael tried to shame David for dancing his own dance. This preacher was up there dancing his own dance, people. I want to also encourage associate ministers, especially young preachers, to read and 1 Kings in the 13th chapter, read that whole chapter and read about the young man of God who was deceived by the old man of God, and he wound up out of God's will because he was deceived. He was listening to the older or more spiritually mature man of God, and he walked out of the way and ended up dead. Spiritual death is going to be at your doorstep if you listen to people who you think know better, too long. And well, they got the Hebrews in the 13th chapter, in the 17th verse says, they got watchers over my, they're watchers over my soul, so I should obey those who are in authority over me. Yes, but keep in mind, that book is written with the assumption that the reader would understand that the watchers of your soul were walking orderly. This is right. Peter was a watcher of people's soul at Antioch, but Peter was out of the way, and he was leading people down the wrong path in the book of Galatians, and this is why Paul said, I confronted him before them all. So again, take scripture in his context. No believer has any obligation to be obedient to somebody that's trying to lead you astray. Nobody does, because those type of people in the book of Matthew are called hirelings. Hirelings see the wolf coming, and they flee because they don't love the sheep. This is what you people have to understand. So read 1 Kings. Read 1 Kings in the 13th chapter, people, and especially associate ministers. You listen to those people, these pastors that think they're the keeper of the oracles, and they are all-knowing and all-wise, and they know better what's better for you than the Bible and the Holy Spirit deals in wants for you. And I know, because I've dealt with that often, being who I am, being a crier, being somebody that the Lord just sent to cry out on sin. People always try to turn me aside, and this is how people do it, especially to people who God raises up to cry against his people in their sin. They'll say, well, you got to show love. You know, you got to tell the truth in love. Let me tell y'all what telling the truth in love is. The telling the truth in love first starts with your motives, but it's like this. It's being not too prophetic and not too priestly or pastorly. Pastors are oftentimes just soft like ice cream with a sugar cone. They are. So you can't be too priestly, and you can't be too prophetic like that, where you are not telling the truth in love. So the middle ground is being priestly and prophetic, which is telling the truth in love. So don't listen to them clowns too long, because you will end up shamed. You'll end up bitter. How many people in the grave, y'all, went to the grave bitter because they weren't dancing their own dance, and they wound up with regret in their lives? There are unpreached sermons in the graveyard. There are unsung songs to Zion in the graveyard. There are wonderful parents in the graveyard who never realized their potential because they were listening to people. You ought to do this and you ought to do that. And I'm going to tell you also, as far as dancing your own dance and being who the Lord's called you to be, married women, the last person you need to be listening to is some single or divorced woman about how to deal with your husband. Because if they're divorced, they failed. Whatever the reason is, their marriage failed. They ain't got no room to tell anybody anything. That's almost like a child molester trying to tell you how to properly love a child. And if she's single, she ain't got no experience, so she need to shut her mouth anyway. So y'all don't need to be listening to them. So also, what my third point is this: dancing your own dance first requires separating your passions from God's passions for you. I read 1 Timothy, read 1 Timothy 2nd and the 3rd chapter. People that have, I'll give you a great example of people that have passion, but it couldn't possibly be God's passion for them because it doesn't line up with his word. Women that say the Lord has told them to pastor and usurp authority over men, the Lord ain't told them that. Again, a pastor, a bishop must be blameless, the husband of one wife, and not the wife of one husband. And you sisters that think you the Lord told you to pastor, you are dancing a dance of the devil. You are dancing a dance of your flesh, because now one of you can support that through God's word. Now, does the Lord call raise up a few women to be prophetesses? Absolutely, because the Bible, Anna was a prophetess in the Bible. We know Deborah was a prophetess in the Bible. I mean, there's examples of that. But the Lord ain't told you to pastor anybody. You are a liar, and the truth is not in you. You have taken your passions, and your passions have driven you away from God's passions for you, sister. So you need to repent. Turn your heart to the Lord Jesus and stop trying to dance the dance of a man, a God-called man. And yeah, I'll say this also. He who desires the office of a bishop desires a good thing. In the book of Timothy, we know that. But again, we have to separate our passions from God's passions for us. Just because I desire that, this doesn't mean that God desires that for me. We go back to the scripture that says, I give some to be prophets, some apostles, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers. Again, Understand that. My fourth point is your drive to please the Lord should never get in the way of his calling for you. Again, your drive to please the Lord should never get in the way of his calling for you, people. And that is very self-explanatory. You go into a fellowship, man, pastors are good at trying to put people on this committee or that committee without ever spending time with them, discipling them, and understanding what their gifts really are. I mean, choirs, for instance, you can sing a little bit. You need to be in the choir. And choirs bring